Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, I thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for your beautiful creation that's all around us, Lord. And today as we come and we study your word, we pray that you'd use Pastor Izzy to speak to each one of us, to meet us where we're at. Lord, the challenges that we face this coming week, the victories that you brought us through, Lord, wherever we're at, Lord, just we know you meet us right there. So, Lord, have your way with us. Let us be clay in the potter's hands, Lord, and we just pray that you'd fill us with your Holy Spirit even now. In Jesus' name we prayed, and everyone agreed said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you grab your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 4 this morning as we're going to continue our study through the book of Romans. We've seen Paul making a great defense of the faith that we have, Paul says it makes us justified before God. And justified, we went over that, is just as if I'd never sinned. If you want to remember what justified is in English in a simplistic way, is just think of justified as just as if I'd never what? Never sinned. It's as if God had taken that sin and washed you so thoroughly, so cleanly. I don't know about you, but anyone like this idea that the Lord, you know what it says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and he's just to what? To forgive us. And this is the part that some people, they just stop at that. Oh, well, he forgave me. But it doesn't stop there. And when John the Apostle wrote 1 John, he said, and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. He cleans us up. It's like wiping the slate completely clean. And for me, that's one of the most things I'm most grateful for, is that God has done that work where he didn't just say, I forgive you. I forgive you, but I'm going to keep that on your... I mean, I'm keeping a record here, like, you know, I'll forgive, but I'm not going to forget. See, Sicilians are good at, I forgive you, but we're not going to forget. And that's not that's not really letting it go. How forgiven do you feel when someone says that to you? I forgive you, but I'm not going to forget. It's not really feel, you're like, thanks for nothing, you know? It doesn't really feel like you're forgiven. But the Bible says we actually know how we ought to love whenever we look at how God loved us. And if we look at how completely he forgives us and he washes us, he goes, start over, do over. You know, we're just going to wipe that away. It's clean. It's a new day. The Bible says his mercies are new every morning. And great is his faithfulness. And so Paul is explaining that we are justified in God's sight simply by one thing. And that thing is just faith. Faith in his son. All we have to do is put our faith in Jesus. Now, Jesus was asked by the Pharisees, you know, what works do we have to do that we could have everlasting life? Do you remember this in John's gospel around chapter 7? He says, what do we do? And he says, here's what you do. You have to do all 10 of the 10 commandments, all 613 of the Levitical statutes, and then you have to give money to the church, right? And you have to get your attendance stickers and put them in, and then you have to teach Sunday school, go on missions, tie to the church, wear holy underwear. I mean, just depends what group you're in. They have all sorts of weird things they add to what you must do, supposedly, to get everlasting life. And you know what Jesus' answer was? None of that stuff. Jesus' answer was real simple. He said, this is the work what you must do to have everlasting life. You must believe in him whom God has sent. Period. Well, who did God send? Jesus. He was just going, all you have to do is believe on me. I paid for the sin. It's a gift. That's what we've been studying. And Paul is now developing this idea. This thing that we have, everlasting life, it's just a gift. And the only thing that you have to do by faith, when someone says, I have a gift for you, you actually don't realize it, but you actually exercise a portion of faith. Every time someone says, I want to give you something, you have to actually believe that they're offering it to you, because for you to respond, you have to believe, well, they're actually offering it, so I'll do what? I'll take it. I'll receive it. And the gift of salvation from God is that all that it is. And some churches, they mucked it up. They put all this extra stuff and rules and trappings in, and it's not the pure gospel as Jesus brought it. Jesus didn't say, you must believe, but you must give for our thermometer on the wall here to go up to the fun drive level. And if you've ever been to those places where it's all about the money or the building or the... Jesus said, no, it's just believe on me. That's it. You get everlasting life. But you don't just get everlasting life. See, Jesus said, I came to give you life and to give it to you what? More abundantly. In the abundant part, this is the part that, now, I've shared this before, but some theologians say the life that he came to give is the life for right now, and the more abundant part is the into eternity, or you can flip it around. It actually isn't in Hebrew either way or in the Greek that you can figure it out, so when I get to heaven, it's on my questions list. Which way did you mean it? But I'm sure I got that both are included. That the portion of eternal life is included in that phrase, and the portion of whatever pertains to life now is included in that phrase. Whatever we need to get through now. And you know, one of the things we need to get through right now, especially in these days what we live, is that knowledge that we have a God that forgives our sins and cleanses. Cleanses from unrighteousness. He washes us clean. Because without that, how do you move forward? You know, we have a lot of folks in our society stuck. They're trapped. They've had some horrible things happen to them in their past, and it's brought deep, deep wounds. And without the knowledge that forgiveness is available through Jesus, and that cleansing of those things, that newness that he offers, they can't move forward. Have you ever met any folks like that? They're like stuck in something that happened in their past, and you're like, you almost want to just help them, you know, like pull them over the hump. Get over that. Let's move on. But without that knowledge, they can't. They're stuck. So Paul is making a case for this faith. How important is faith? This faith, what we have, to get us to go forward. I mean, this is the thing that takes the past and severs it so that we are now free to move on. And so Paul, he's been describing how Abraham believed God when God spoke something to him. And just because he believed, God said, I count that. In my book, that counts as righteousness. You're right with me because I said I'm going to do this for you, and you believed it, and so you're solid with me. That's all it takes. But I mentioned it because as I was telling the story that Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness, we're going to pick up today in Romans chapter 4 that he believed God in verse 3 and it was credited to him as righteousness, and it wasn't credited to him as righteousness by any works. He didn't do some spiritual works for this credit. He was just credited because he said, I believe. He had faith. Now he says, the one that works is, he is credited not as favor, but as what is due. The one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness. Just as David also speaks, and this is what we got to last week, what David, beautiful psalm that he wrote, he said, blessings are on the man to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. For how blessed is those that their lawless deeds have been forgiven and whose sins have been what? Washed or covered up. Blessed means how happy. How happy are you when you find out your sins are forgiven and covered or washed? They're gone. God covered it. He's got you covered. Blessed is the man, verse 8, this is where we ended, that whose sin the Lord will not take into account. Oh, man, that is, how happy. You know, some people ask you, why are you so happy? You don't understand. I mean, seriously, God said, I'm not going to take your sin into account. I'm not keeping it on my record book. I let it go. I erased the ledger. You said, please forgive me, and I whipped out my big eraser, and I just went, and it's gone. And it's gone so good, you can't even trace over and find anything. I mean, he just makes the slate clean. How happy does that make you feel to know God forgives like that? I don't know about you, but when I hear that, I go like, oh, man, that is really good for my soul. I need that. Now, we saw last week, is this blessing then on the... That was... He believed in that. It says his faith was justified before the law, not by the law. And I mentioned last week, the law was not yet to come. I mean, Moses hadn't even been born yet. Abraham has to have Isaac. Isaac has to have Jacob. He wrestles an angel, gets his name changed to Israel. He has 12 sons. One of them's Levi. Levi has Korath. Korath has Amram. Amram has Moses and his cousin Aaron. And those two guys go up to the mount. And Aaron then says, you stay here. Aaron's down there making a golden calf. Moses is up on the mountain. He gets the law. By the way, what I just did was recap about 690 years of history. Okay, just in the genealogical tree from Abram to Moses. The only reason I do that is because some Christians aren't familiar with the Old Testament. And they don't know that the law that Moses, those Ten Commandments, came almost seven, just for easy remembering, sometimes people like even numbers, around 700 years later would come the law. So you might run into some people that are very into, we ought to follow the law, we got to follow the rules, you know. And you're like, I follow the guy who's called the father of the faith. His name is Abram. He got changed to Abraham. We're going to look at that in a minute. And he's the guy who it says is the father of the ones under the law and also the ones that are not under the law. To the Jew and the Gentile alike, he's called the father of all nations, many nations. He's a blessing to the world. Why was he a blessing? Because he set the example. He's called the father of the what? Do you guys know this title? It's used in Israel all the time. Abram has this title, and it's a really important title. He's called the father of the faith. Not the father of the law, or the father of the works, or the father of the works of the law, or the father of the circumcised. He's called the father of the faith. And sometimes, I don't know, have any of you run into these Christian groups where they have a lot of works, a lot of rules that you have to do to be in their group? I mean, you join up, and the first thing they're like, so, do you eat meat? Or do you eat pork? Or do you have, whatever. They have so many different spins on works that they believe make them more godly. When I say, wait a minute, that stuff wasn't even around. And did Abraham please God with his faith? He couldn't do the works of the law because the law wasn't there yet. So just a little technicality, but you might want to know this stuff because someone might whip it on you. They might say, you need to be like our group. We follow all these rules. And you go, well, I follow the guy who is considered by all the guys that follow the rules, the great-great-grandfather, great-great-great-great-great-granddaddy of the faith, Abraham. Because if you're talking who's who in the, you know, you go to Israel, you want to talk who's who in the zoo, so to speak, spiritually. Who trumps, Abraham or Moses? Abraham. He is the one that has the, you know, he's like really endeared because of this reason. And sometimes people don't know this. You know, in Western Christianity, they're not studied in these things. They don't know the history of all these guys and who begot who and all that stuff. They're just like, yeah, it's boring. Skip to the other stuff. Right? Unfortunately, it lets guys who are false teachers slip in and teach stuff that sounds good to the ear, but it's not really sound to the doctrine of the scripture. And it gets people into bondage. That they start to try to please God by works instead of by faith. You know, it says without faith in the book of Hebrews, it's impossible to please God. It does not say without works, it's impossible. It says without faith. Faith is the thing that will initiate any work that you do. But it comes back down to faith is the important thing. It's the real true thing that we need to hold fast to. And if anyone asks you, so who are you really into? Just go, I go with Abraham, father of the faith. He was the one who was told he'd be blessing to all the nations. because he set an example of believing God. His word, whatever God said, he went, I believe you. Now, I pointed out last week, God told him at 75 years old, took him out and said, look at the stars in the heavens. Can you count them? And he went, and he says, so shall your descendants be. He was 75. His wife is about 65. They had no children. And he went, you say so, Lord. I believe you. And do you guys know from that point? Oh, someone asked me last week, where was the story what he was telling in, you know, about Abraham and Hagar and the maidservant and all that? This is Genesis, the very first book of the Bible. In Genesis 15 to 18, I kind of summed up Genesis, three of the chapters, actually. I just kind of did a quick speed through, you know, Reader's Digest for you last week to put you the details to kind of let you know who came into the story and how Abraham, God said, look at the stars, you're going to have descendants. And he's going, yeah, well, I'm not a spring chicken anymore. We don't have any kids. But if you know what he said? This is really interesting. He said, but if you say so, God, if you say, then I believe you. In other words, I believe what you say. And that's why, by the way, God said to him, I count that as righteousness, because you had faith in what I said. You just had faith. Now, last week I pointed out, did he have a baby right away with Sarah? 25 years later. No, by the way, I did mention the story about how, you know, after about 10 years, it wasn't really happening quick enough. So at about 86, when he's 86, I didn't mention this part of the story, but what had happened was God said, you come follow me. I'm going to take you from Ur of Chaldees, over there, what we would call in modern-day Babylon, and I'm going to bring you over to the promised land, Canaan's land. And he gets towards Canaan's land, and there's a famine in the land, so he departs down to Egypt. And he stays in Egypt through the whole time of the famine. And he, you know, Abram was actually a man of quite, we'd say, a good way. I mean, he had servants and wealth and flocks, and he got a maidservant for his wife named Hagar, the Egyptian. She was brought from Egypt with them, and they came back to, when the famine was over, they come back to the promised land, and Sarah's like, you know, God gave you that promise about the sand and the seashore thing. You keep talking about that, Abram. It's been like 11 years. Nothing's happened. Why don't you go into my maidservant, Hagar, and have a child with her? And when you do, I'll catch the child and raise it as our own, and we'll help God along with this whole get the descendants as the sand and the sea. It's not happening with me. And Sarah, you know, this. But as soon as... This was Sarah's idea, by the way. You guys know this in the story? It was her idea to do this. As soon as the baby's born, do you guys know if Sarah liked Hagar anymore? No, it says she despised her. And there was that jealousy. You know, now she knew it wasn't him that was broken. It was her. Abram could still have kids, but she wasn't. And she felt even worse, and she drove Hagar away, and an angel of the Lord met Hagar. This is extra credit reading for you if you want to read Genesis 16, 17. The angel meets her and says, listen, what are you doing over here? Oh, my, you know, Sarah doesn't want me around anymore. And she said, you return. I'm going to take this son. And the angel said, here's the blessing. You know, I'm going to, even though this was an effort of the flesh, I'm going to still use this boy, and he's going to become the father of the Ishmaelites. And so she's encouraged to go back. She goes back and she serves there. And this young man is growing up in the house with Abram and Sarah, and they're there until he's 13 years old. And at this point, we come into the story. And this is the part I would like to turn with you to show you something that ties into Romans. Paul actually is going to quote it today in the passage. So I want to show you where he's getting his information from. If you turn with me to Genesis chapter 17, it says in verse 1, now when Abram was 99 years old, Isaac is about 13. So just to give you a clue, they've been waiting now about 23, 24 years. I'm sorry, Ishmael. Ishmael is 30. I'm sorry, did I say Isaac? Ish, slip of the tongue. Ishmael is 13. And so the Lord then appears to Abram again. Now, the Lord had appeared to him when he was 75. We read about that in Ur of Chaldees and told him, you go, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to do these things. And he believed God. And I believe that's in Genesis, chapter 12, verse 4, when he departs. He's 75 years old. So he gets the first encounter with the Lord at 75. And now we're here almost 25 years. Now, I don't like to point this out. I mentioned it last week at the end of the sermon. Because, you know, we're cheating. We're seeing a guy's life compressed into a couple pages of the book. And it's so easy to see on this page God speaking to him. And then you flip a couple pages, there's God speaking to him again. And if you're not paying attention to the details, you don't catch that 25 years went from the first time he got the speaking to till, you know, the next time. And it's actually, you go, in between, by the way, there is two other times. So in 25 years, we only get four little conversations. You know, spread it out. That's what, one every, you know, 10, well, let's see, four for 24, so every 7 years. You know, some of you are like, I wish God would speak to me like he spoke to Abraham. I'm like, no, you wish he would speak to you all the time, not wait 7 years for each interim or wait 15 years and then wait, you know, give you a little visit. And then, I mean, this guy had to wait. And not only did he have to wait for God to speak, he had to wait for God to bring about the promise that God said. Now, I don't like this part. In fact, I don't think I should teach you this, but I have to. Because, see, when God says he's going to do something, will he do it? Yes. Does that mean he'll do it right away? Not in our right away. Now, to him, 25 years, it's not even an hour. In God's, you know, day is 1,000 years, 1,000 years is a day. An hour is 41 years of our time, if you want to use that equation. You know, one day to God is 1,000 years to us. So 1 hour to God, 41 and something, 0.67 years to us. It's a long wait to us. But about a half an hour for God later, he comes back to visit Abram. And he's now 99 years old. And he says, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, Abram. I will establish my covenant between me and you. I will multiply you exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, it says in verse 3, Genesis 17. And God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you. And you will be the father of a multitude of nations. He says, no longer shall your name be called Abram. Instead, it shall be Abraham. For I have made you a father of a multitude of nations. Now, if you don't know Hebrew, Abba or Ab is... Abba is father. Abba is the, like how we say dad, daddy and dad, you know, like dada. Abba is, or Ab is like dada. It's the contracted form, means father. And so Abram is a father of exalted father. The only problem is his name was exalted father and he had no kids. Okay, I mean, until the first time the Lord meets him, hey, exalted father, yeah, you're going to have kids like the stars of the heaven, like the sand of the seashore. And he's like, okay, if you say so. I mean, it is my name, but I don't have any kids yet. I'm 75. The Lord comes back and says, I'm going to establish my covenant with you and between me and between your descendants, and you're going to be blessed, a father of a multitude of nations. Abraham is a father of many, multitude of peoples. So he's saying, I'm going to change it from just exalted father to a father of many nations. Multitude of nations, we'd say in English. So this is your name change. And no longer will you be called this, but instead you'll be called Abraham. And I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make the nations of you, nations of you, and kings will come forth from you. Now, did kings ever come forth from the lineage of Abraham? Oh, yes, they did. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants throughout the generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you. And I will give to you and to your descendants after you the land of your sojournings and the land of Canaan for an everlasting possession. I will be their God. Then God said further to Abraham, now as for you, you shall keep my covenant and you and your descendants after you throughout the generations. This is my covenant, he says, which you shall keep between me and you and your descendants after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. Every male amongst you who is 8 days old shall be circumcised throughout your generations. A servant who's born in your house or who has been bought by money or from any foreigner who is not of your descendants. Everyone that is part of your house, this is the sign that they shall have. They'll be circumcised. And a servant who is born in your house or who's been brought with money shall surely be circumcised. And that shall be my covenant. It will be in your flesh for an everlasting. Do you think God picks a personal thing to deal with here? I'm going to make a sign between men and God, like in a private, personal way, that they will know we have a deal. I mean, those of you who don't know what circumcision is, the cutting away of the foreskin of the private parts. And this is like, he's getting them where it hurts, you know, like below the belt. But he gets their attention, you know, like this is the sign we're going to have. And it's going to be for a covenant. So you know that we're playing, you know, for keeps here. Now, in the New Testament, Paul, when he writes about this circumcision of the flesh, he says this was to be, the Jews like this kind of thing, this is to show a type of lifestyle, what the cutting away of the foreskin takes away the some of the pleasures receptacles on the private parts, so that no longer is the life led after just the flesh, the carnal desires, but now it's to be led after God. And so it's taught in Jewish culture, this is to be, you know, in a simple way, but to remember our lives have godly purpose, not just carnal, fleshly drive. And those of you guys that know how what guys are wired, this is very appropriate what God is doing here, picking on guys in the right way here. So then God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, and by the way, her name used to be called Sarai. Sarai in Hebrew is princess. He says, Sarai is, that's Mara, is bitter. Sarai is, I know this too. I have it in my old Bible written down. Because Sarah is princess. Sarai is, I'll have to look again. I'm sorry, my brain is. Does anyone have a note? She's saying bitter, but that's Mara. This is verse 15 of Genesis 17. Someone might have one of those smartphones. You can type in Sarai and see what it translates. He says, as for her, I'm going to bless her. Indeed, you will give her a son by her. They both mean princess? Well, yeah, but there's another meaning to my princess. He says, Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. And kings of peoples will come from her. And listen to this. Now, I mentioned last week when the angel showed up to Abram and said, you're going to be with child next year, that Sarah was in the tent. And what did Sarah do then? She laughed. And he went in and said, you laughed. And she said, oh, I didn't laugh. She was embarrassed, you know. I didn't laugh. And yes, you did. But I didn't mention this part of the story. See, Abram believed God, right? But I want to point out something here. Have you ever laughed so hard that you fell down on your face, just cracking up? I mean, just really heavy, heavy laughing. Sarah might have laughed in the tent. But listen to what Abraham did. Verse 17 of Genesis 17. Genesis 17:17 says, then Abraham fell on his face and laughed. Now, this is a guy who believed God, right? He believes God. But just because you believe God says you're going to do something, does it not mean that God sometimes what he says? Yeah, you know he's got a sense of humor. You're like cracking up. You've got to be kidding me. God, you're going to do what? I remember when the Lord told me to go from Arizona, this guy, Wally Takaki, came and said, you have to go to the Big Island. You. And share the gospel there, because you're laid back. And he grew up here. He was born in Hilo, born and raised. And he was one of the elders in our fellowship there at Calvary Tri-City. And he goes, you have to go. And I remember laughing inside, like, did you hear that, God? I have to go to Hawaii. You know, you got to be, like, that's a punishment? What? I mean, sure. I couldn't believe it. I mean, I believed it, but inside I was, like, really? I have to, and sometimes the Lord says, I'm going to do something in your life, and you're just going, uh-huh, really? And you might even get a good chuckle out of it. This guy, he laughed. Now, I mentioned last week, God's going to get the last laugh. You know why? What do they name the boy when he's born? He laughs. Isaac means he, as in capital H, God. He laughs. He gets the last laugh. He goes, when you name the boy, name him, he laughs. The Lord laughs. You know, you think it's so funny, like, I can't do this. You were laughing about it. Your wife was laughing. I'm just going to put this down in history for the annals, just so that from then on they'll remember. To the guy who is the father of the faith, he had a boy, a promised boy, not the one that he helped God out with, Ishmael, but the one of the promise, Isaac. And his name means God got the last laugh. God went, you laughed at me. I'm going to laugh at you. Wait till you get this kid. And so we see a year later he's born.
Sarai means argumentative.
Or quarrelsome. Yes, yeah, so he said, you know, we're going to change your name to princess from argumentative or quarrelsome. That Sarai was argumentative. Not Sarai, right? To princess. So she, I just thought it was funny that he is falling on his face. And he says, while he's laughing, will a child be born to a man 100 years old? And will Sarah, who's 90 years old, bear a child? And Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. Look, God, we already got a kid. Just use him. But God said, no. But Sarah, your wife, will bear a son, and you will call him Isaac. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and for his descendants after him. If you want to read Galatians chapter 4, verses 21 to 31, for a little extra insight on that covenant that God makes, the one of the promise versus the one of the he calls the child the child of promise, and the other child the child of born of the flesh, and the flesh's efforts, and so. God has him be circumcised, and then a year later, Isaac comes, God fulfills the promise. Now, I have a question for you. Did Abram believe God first, or did he get circumcised first? He believed first. Okay, and I only had to read you this to point this out, because if you were Jewish, you would already know this, because they teach it at Shabbat school. You have to learn all these little, it's like Sunday school for us. They know these stories, but we don't know them. So turn back with me to Romans now, and you might hear something you might have missed, not knowing the order of things. But see, Paul is going to point out, first, faith came to Abraham, and he believed, and God reckoned it as righteousness, even before the law. Now he's going to deal with another misconception. Remember, he's writing to the church at Rome. Okay, these are Roman believers. A lot of them didn't grow up in Jewish culture, so they don't know. It's just the same as us. They don't know. When did circumcision come? When did, you know, the law come? When did all that stuff come? So they're just operating on what they know. And so Paul writes, he says, verse 9, Romans 4, 9, is this blessing then on the circumcised or on the uncircumcised? For we say faith was credited to Abraham as righteousness. How then was it credited? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? And to answer it, Paul says, no. Not while circumcised, but while uncircumcised. The circumcision was not something that made him right with God and approved. It was something as a sign of a covenant that God promised after he already believed. You say, what's the big deal? Well, what's the emphasis on then? Circumcision or belief? Belief. Faith. That's what it comes to. So he received the sign of circumcision as a seal of righteousness, of the faith which he had already while uncircumcised. And so that he, it says, might be the father of all who believe, without being circumcised, that righteousness might be credited to them, and the father of the circumcision to those who are of the circumcision, but also who follow in the steps of the faith of our father Abraham, which he had while uncircumcised. So he's the father to both groups. And that's what Paul's trying to point out. Because in the Roman church, do you think there were people that were of the circumcision and those that were uncircumcised? Yes. And unfortunately, I hate to tell you this, but if you hang out with some Jewish folks who are circumcised, do they sometimes act like they're better than the uncircumcised fellows in the locker room? I mean, if you've never been, I was an athlete growing up. If you've never been around the different folks, some of these guys, they just have an attitude. Like, we're the favorites. We're the only ones approved by God. And you're like, wait a minute. Was your father of the faith Abraham? And they'll go, yeah. This one, it's good to know the story. So you hold that he's really, you know, high up in the whole spiritual who's who. Yeah. He's father of the faith, man. Yeah, so was he circumcised when he got that title? No, wait, think about it. I just want you to know this part. No! Is this important to know? Yes. Because sometimes there are these groups that try to lull you into their false misconceptions by saying you have to do certain things to please God, and once you do them, then you can be in the faith club. Where God didn't make that part of the rule because it wasn't even included. Abraham was the father of the faith club before the circumcision came. Before the law came, before all those stupid rules that people make up, you find out that there's a God who makes men justified, just as if they'd never sinned, just by one thing, faith. Just faith. So is faith important? Absolutely. The Bible says, how will they hear unless there's a preacher? How do they have faith? Faith comes by hearing. You need somebody to share that. Now, verse 13 says in Romans 4, this promise to Abraham and to his descendants that the world would be heir, that he would be heir of the world was not through the law, but it was through righteousness of faith. For if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void, and the promise is nullified. For the law brings about wrath, but where there is no law, there is no violation. This is an interesting point that Paul's making here. You know, without any law, it's impossible to break the law. I mean, the kids, I remember when I was young, maybe I shouldn't say this on camera, but I loved to drive fast. You know, I mean, cars have big engines for a reason. That's why I grew up in the era where, you know, you get a Chevy SS Nova, put a nitrous oxide, set, you know, 462 engine and bore it up, and then, you know, go down the highway. In northern Arizona, it was already 85 mile an hour speed limit stretches. Then you flip that switch, and it pins you back to the seat, and all of a sudden you're up at about 145, 50, and you're just, the little barriers are going, and you hit a little bump, and the car goes up in the air, and you get that little weightless feeling under your stomach, and then the car goes down, and you're still in the air, and I love the up and downs, man. At 150, it's just. But got a question for you. If we were to have a flat, a blowout at that speed, one of those old cars, do you know, like, would it be safe? Especially seeing that we didn't actually wear seatbelts back then. And you think, you know, this is the era before that was mandatory law that you had to wear your seatbelt and all that. Why did they make that law anyway? Well, because they're mad at us, right? They wanted to make us really uncomfortable and restrict our movement in the car and just ruin our day when we drive, right? That's why they did that. No. Because they knew it would save lives. Because the reality is we do get blowouts. We do have accidents. We do have stuff go wrong. And they're not called on purposes that we had a, you know, collision with somebody. It's called an accident for a reason. But they happen. And I remember when I was young, I heard of this place called the Autobahn. And they said there's no speed limit. You could go as fast as the car could go. I was like, I live in the wrong country. You know, I need to go there and drive because, like, you're allowed to go as fast as your car can go. But over there, you're also responsible if you get in an accident for your own driving. You cause an accident, you pay. You're fully responsible. You can go as fast as you want, but they have this responsibility kind of thing included in their books. And just because you can go as fast as the car could humanly go, you know, I mean, its capabilities, does that make it safe to go that fast on all those roads? No. And when there is no law, it's impossible to break the speed limit law. Okay? But it doesn't mean it's impossible to do something stupid. And it doesn't mean that it's impossible for us to do stuff that's dangerous to our own. I mean, it's to our own detriment sometimes what we do. Even though it's legal, we sometimes do what's legal but not safe. Anyone can give an amen to that, that in life we might do that? Even if it's legal. Well, it's legal, Pastor, that I could do this. Yeah. Is it safe for you? No. I've done enough of those not safe things to understand when Paul says here, when there is no law, there's no violation. But see, sometimes we forget the spirit of the law isn't because of the punishment. It's for the protection. You know, maybe it's just to keep you. And you do know that on the Big Island, right? If they have a speed limit sign when you're going down south on some of those hairpin turns and you see a speed limit sign, some people say, well, those are just suggested speeds to go. Listen. On our island, they don't put up a sign until after there's like 3 or 4 deaths on that curve. So just so you know, when we moved here 24 years ago, hardly any speed limits anywhere around the whole island. The whole Belt Road, you could go, you wouldn't see a speed limit. Problem is that they wait 3 or 4 people die on that curve, then they put a sign to slow down there. I tell my friends visiting, if you see the sign, slow down at least for the next couple curves. It means somebody died, not just one. Because they don't even do it if just one dies. One dies, not ready, just make a mark. 2, 3, okay, 4 times, we got to put a sign up. And you say, I'm joking. Look at where the signs are. Those of you who've lived here long enough, you know where the accidents have happened. You know, that's how they do it. Now, the law might be slow down to this, but is it because it's mad at us? No. See, sometimes we forget. God says, I put authorities there to look after you. They got a purpose. But we're always like, we forget the purpose. And some people, they forget the faith, and then they want to mix in spiritual laws, and they muck it all up. And Paul, he says, listen, verse 16, he says, for this reason, it is by faith, in order that it may be in accordance with grace, that so that all that the promise would be guaranteed to all the descendants, not only to those of the law, but to those who are of the faith of Abraham, the father of us all. As it is written, a father of many nations have I made you, in the presence of him who believed, even God, who gives life to the dead and calls into being that which does not exist. Here's Abram going, I'm almost 100, God, my wife, she's, you know, 10 years younger, 90. God, how are we going to have a baby? And Paul says, God can bring life even to the dead, to that what doesn't even exist. In verse 18, I love this line. In hope against hope, he believed. Have you ever felt like sometimes there's things that just, it literally is beyond just... What an expression, hope against hope, he believed. It seemed hopeless to him. Yet he hoped in what God said, so that he might become the father of many nations according to that which had been spoken, so shall your descendants be. Now, without becoming weak in his faith, he contemplated his own body, now as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and he considered the deadness of Sarah's womb. Yet in respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but he grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. This is something we don't really perceive, that over 25 years of waiting, instead of going, God, I don't believe, my faith is failing, my faith, it says he actually grew in faith. After 25 years, God has revisited him and repeated the promise. And he's like, you say so. I believed you when I was 75. I believed you when you visited last. I believe you now even more. And being fully assured that what God had promised, God was able to. How many of you believe if God promises something, he's able to pull it off? This is really important for our faith to understand. We're talking about a guy who doesn't have limits. If he makes a promise, he can pull it off. Therefore, it was also credited to Abram as righteousness. Now, this was not written for his sake only. This is the close. Pay attention right here. It was written for whose sake? That it was credited, yes, for our sake also. To whom it is credited that those who would believe in him whom raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, for he was delivered over because of our transgression. He was raised because of our justification. And therefore, chapter 5, verse 1, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus, through whom we also have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand. That's as far as I want to go this morning, because we have had a wonderful introduction by faith into grace. You know, and it's a simple thing. You know, we just heard that God said, I want to wipe your slate clean. Would you like that? Would you like me to do that for you? And when we hear that, there's a part of us wired by God inside. Our spirit goes, yeah, I'll take that. I mean, it's not it's not anything I have to sell. I'm not here to sell you this. This is something God said I offer as a gift from God to you. He's offered that gift to me, and I'm just telling you, as a person who took him up on his offer, for those of you who took him up on an offer, is it a good deal when we take him up on this offer? How does it, listen to what it says. Therefore, having been justified, which means just as if I never what? Sinned by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ our Lord. I don't know about you, but this is one thing I can personally attest to, that when I put my faith, when I heard this message and I said, okay, I want that to count for me. What do I do? Is there some, like, I was raised Catholic, so is there a certain prayer, you know, Hail Mary, Our Father? We were taught certain prayers for different things. So I'm like, what's the prayer? And the pastor says, well, it's not like you're thinking, but it's just talk to God and say, God, I acknowledge my sin. I confess I have sin. Because remember, if we confess our sin, what's he do? Faithful and just to forgive and cleanse. So confess your sin to him and ask for his forgiveness. And I go, okay. And then God, forgive me and cleanse me. And I no sooner have finished that prayer than there is this cool thing that I cannot describe. It says here we have peace. Because of this, we have peace with God. All of a sudden, I was like, like before, it was always a fight. Something in me fought against God. Maybe you didn't, but I'm just saying inside me, there wasn't that, we were not at peace. I can just say it. I know inside me that, does anyone identify with what I'm saying? As soon as I said, God, you forgive me and wipe away my sins, cleanse me, all of a sudden, this peace came over me that, beyond human words, I mean, it was a peace in the inside of my soul. I was like, life is good. I mean, all of a sudden, life became really good. With that peace that I can't put it into words. I mean, it's just what Paul is saying here. Because of this simple act of faith in Christ, we get introduced into this sweet grace, and now we get peace with God through Jesus. And guys, I want to, you know, sometimes you might hear at a minister closes sermon, may the peace of the Lord be with you, may he go with you, right? And he sends you off in the peace of God. Truly, I'd like to end today that his peace would be on all of you. Because some people are wrestling with this. They don't have peace right now. They're, you know, inside there's a turmoil. And they don't know about this sweet grace that God is saying, come, you can be in this place with me, a place where I pour out my gifts to you, my grace, my forgiveness, and my what? My cleansing. Let God wipe you clean so that you can just start off your week feeling refreshed and feeling at peace inside. You know, there's sometimes stuff steals our peace. Sometimes it's just a rough week can take away our peace. And we just need that. We just need to be a little reminder to go back to stand in grace. They're having fun over there. I want to go over there. We got to finish now. Let's pray. Father, I do pray that we would all come into your peace. If there's anyone listening to this, they've never experienced what we're talking about. We just pray for them this morning, right now, that you would just help them to just confess their sin to you and to allow you to wash it away, to cleanse it from all unrighteousness, to take away those things and free, bring true free release from the past, from the hurts, from anything that would hold back. And we too, Lord, we want to continue echoing those prayers to you, that you continue that work of releasing us, Lord, from any bonds, anything that drags us back away from walking with you. Lord, forgive us this morning our sins. Cleanse us. Send us out from here filled with your grace and your peace. And I ask that now in the name of your Son, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Well, may the peace of the Lord truly.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.